Program By His Stripes. My name is Brian Mason, and I'm sitting in for Margaret Ransfield. There are many wonderful promises in the Word of God concerning healing. I am the Lord that healeth thee, says Exodus chapter 15. And verse 26. I'm going to start. I found a hymn, actually, that refers to Christ the healer. This is so wonderful, because there don't appear to be all that many hymns that do refer to him as the healer. But this one by F. Pratt Green. Never used it before, but it's so appropriate to this program. O Christ the healer, we have come to pray for health, to plead for friends. How can we fail to be restored when reached by love that never ends? From every ailment flesh endures, our bodies clamour to be freed. Yet in our hearts we would confess that wholeness is our deepest need. How strong, O Lord, are our desires, how weak our knowledge of ourselves. Release in us those healing truths unconscious pride resists or shells. In conflicts that destroy our health, we diagnose the world's disease. Our common life declares our ills. Is there no cure, O Christ, for these? Father God, as we draw aside to spend this time in thy wonderful and glorious presence, and to know that the Lord Jesus Christ is the same, this yesterday, today, and forever, and that healing is still there, in the person of thy beloved one. And this program seeks to prove that the ancient healing power and the authority in the name of Jesus is still there. That as those of the past have proved, like Smith Wigglesworth, who have the audacity of faith and to see thee move, it is the power of the Holy Spirit through Jesus that heals. And that healing touch will still do the same in this program, even though I don't know who's going to be watching, listening. Whatever their needs are, they're unknown to me, but they're known to Jesus, and Jesus will heal when there is faith to expect him to heal. For, O Father God, it is asked in the name above all other names, the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who what has power. Power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. The power to wash away sin and the power to bring healing through the atoning blood that he shed on the cross of Calvary. For Jesus said, if ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. For it is asked in his name, and for thy glory and thy glory alone, O Father God, that you will be all in all, that thy servant will just be the vessel. He won't be seen. And Jesus and Jesus only will be seen. Amen. It's as we stand on the Word of God, the unchangeable Word of God, not the ever-changing Word of God of the modern translations, but the King James Authorized Version, known in the past to men like Smith Wigglesworth and Rhys Howells, and they've proved time and time again that on this unchangeable Word of the unchangeable God, that the power and the authority in the name and through the name of the Lord Jesus Christ moves and heals those, no matter what their need might be. In the Old Testament, in Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 5, we have these wonderful, wonderful words, speaking of one who only could be the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Couldn't be anybody, couldn't just be a man. It had to be God. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Healed. There again, in the Word of God, healed. Have you that expectancy to be healed today? Because without faith, without reaching out in faith, without knowing the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, first is that reconciliation with God himself. For Jesus, he was sent by the Father to come into this world. The very Creator God came into this world. He came as man, so that sin and Satan, the very power of sin and Satan, what? It could be destroyed. Because it was through what is called redemption. That is the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ, the Redeemer. Sin had done its worst. That when sin came upon all mankind, through the disobedience of Adam and Eve, Man lost his privileged position of being able to walk with God in fellowship with his Creator. And darkness came into the heart of every man and woman, everyone born since Adam. And it's without knowing the Lord Jesus Christ as a personal Savior, then you're still walking in darkness. Oh, what it cost the Father to send his Son, his only begotten Son, to be the Redeemer. And that it was through the blood of Jesus that every sinner, without exception, is able to repent of their sin. Not a popular word these days, sin. Christendom, including the emerging church, looks to take away the need to preach of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. But Jesus came. And what did he do at Calvary? He made it all possible. He made it a fact that whosoever comes to him first to have their sin removed. And then should there be a need at any time for healing, healing of the whole man, of body, of mind, of spirit. Our God is not the God of the partial healing. He's the God of wholeness. The God who gives his own life that we might have him within ourselves. Why did God create man? It was to share fellowship with him, to share his life with him. Jesus is God with us. And when we come to know him, to receive him as our personal Savior, as the only Redeemer, the only one who by his blood can wash and cleanse away sin and restore communication with God on an individual basis. It has to be individually applied by God. God is a spirit. But man, without receiving the Spirit of God, he's dead to God, doesn't know God, absolutely cut off from God. But in Jesus, he gives this wonderful offer to cleanse away our sin and to come and live his life within these weak human vessels. Yes, sin had brought man. Man by nature is deprived, absolutely deprived, because sin condemns man in the sight of a holy God. But yet, here we are, this wonderful, wonderful plan of God to restore mankind individually. First, to be in communion with himself, to be able to communicate, be able to have fellowship with God, to know that wonderful presence of peace of God. And whatever the need might be for healing, to come unto whom? A faithful God, a loving God, a God of compassion, a God who in Jesus Christ is able to come and meet whatever the need might be. How do we see this? Again, drawing upon Scripture. In 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 24, we read, who, his own self, and that can only refer to Jesus Christ, the eternal co-equal Son of God. There are sins in his own body on the tree. Our sins, my sin, your sin, and everyone else's sin, took it in his own body. No wonder the Father could not look upon him, because Jesus was made a curse. Everyone who's on the tree, nailed to a tree, crucified, is a curse in the sight of a holy God. That's what it cost Jesus, to lose the smile of the Father. That we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. Ye were healed. Healed when sin has been dealt with. Righteousness, being made right with God, receiving the righteousness of God. Because righteousness can only be obtained, it's been obtained by Jesus Christ, and it comes as a gift to the repentant sinner. Oh, our God is so gracious. He took the wrath which sin demanded judgment upon sin. And Jesus took it all upon himself and became the one perfect offering for sin forever. But again, it has to be individually applied. And it's by the grace of God that is applied. We can't do it of ourselves. We can't bring our filthy rags of self-righteousness and self-works. It has to be by grace. And the Father. It's the Father who draws the sinner to Jesus. Grace, all of grace, none of self. Now that's the basis, the foundation of which we can move now and see how Jesus so wonderfully, during his earthly ministry, showed the compassion of God. Even before he'd gone to the cross, that wherever there was a need, he could not say no. No matter how weak or how loud he was called upon, he heard and out of the loving heart of compassion, the loving heart of God Himself, came that power and authority as the Holy Spirit, because Jesus, during His earthly ministry, was dependent upon the Holy Spirit, the same Holy Spirit who indwells those who belong to Him. This servant knows it is the same Holy Spirit that indwelt Jesus, and that's the confidence he has, that when prayer is made later in the program, it will be by the same power and authority which Jesus acted in. If you'd like to turn with me to St. Luke's Gospel and chapter 17. And verses, I'll read them, verses 11 to 18 inclusive. And it came to pass, as he went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. And when he saw them, he said unto them, Go, show yourselves unto the priests. And it came to pass that, as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, and with a loud voice glorified God, and fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks, and he was a Samaritan. And Jesus answered, said, Were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? There are not found that return to give glory to God, save this stranger. And he said unto him, Arise, go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole. Yes, there was Jesus on his way to Jerusalem, and had to pass through this village where these dear men, in their great need, were. Whether Jesus knew that there were 10 men waiting, don't know. But the one thing we do know, that word had reached these 10 men, that there was someone coming that way, who, what, was a great, great teacher of the Word of God, a healer of whatever the disease might be. Jesus is the first and the authoritative one who, what, can heal all diseases, whether it be cancer, some infectious disease, heart disease, blindness, deafness, cripple. Nothing is beyond him, the very creator of man nothing beyond him. Because he created man perfectly, it was only sin and Satan which took man out of being what God had created him to be. Oh, people are so slow to come to the one who is the perfect healer. And the one whom, when physicians and doctors are unable to do any more for them, the incurable, those who are beyond hope, and death is approaching them, Jesus is God's perfect answer. Because, as I already said, it's the power of the authority in the name of Jesus, by the Holy Spirit, that brings what divine healing. Not human healing, it's divine healing. And these men, not only had they leprosy, but because they were lepers, they were outcasts of society. They had to be in their own colony, having food brought to them, thrown as it were to them, because they were not permitted to go into the village. They were cut off from their families. They were cut off from all others. It was only the lepers who had to spend time with themselves, because no one wanted to become a leper. No one wanted to catch what they had, to have that awful disease. But that disease was not beyond the Creator God, the Redeemer, the one who restores us back to what God had created us for by giving fellowship. When we come to him, when we've been restored to him, the Father, through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, the blood which is not spoken of much in these days, but the Holy Spirit has laid it upon me that what he's doing is these days, he's bringing about a reformation. And what is central to that reformation? The blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, which cleanseth from all sin. And the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, which made the perfect atonement for the healing of every disease. Yes, these men stood afar off, but the word had come about this man, this wonderful man, and their hope was placed in him. How their hearts yearned, oh, that he won't go past, that he won't just go past where we are. We're cut off, we're away from the route that he's taking. But they weren't put off, that we all, that they could muster, they cried unto him, lifted up their voices. Have you cried unto the Lord Jesus? Have you the same faith as these 10 men had, They had their trust in him, and they were determined that they won't go by without hearing him, them cry unto him. Have you got that same desire to receive what only he can give? Of what did they cry? They recognized that he was whom he was. They acknowledged him. They called him Huat, Master. Have mercy on us. They acknowledged him as God. No one else, no human could have mercy on them. God himself in Christ reconciled, yes. And here they'd seen that there was one who could reconcile them to God and heal them at the same time. What did Jesus say unto them? Be healed? No, he didn't actually say that. What did he say? Go yourself, show yourselves unto the priests. And saying that, yes, anyone who was healed at that time, in that society, who was a leper, he had first to go and show themselves unto the priests, and the priests would then allow them to return to a normal life within the village or the town or the city. Jesus, in his word of authority, now this was a divine word from the Divine One, because he was saying unto them, you are healed. Because if they weren't healed, then there was no point in them going to the priest. And it came to pass that as they went, they were cleansed. Oh, how wonderful to know that we are cleansed. Cleansed, yes. When our sins are being forgiven and we are restored to God, we know God as our Father and cleansed too. So to receive that healing touch from the one who will reach out and heal. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, and with a loud voice glorified God. Healing is not for our glory. It's for the glory of God himself. I know when I was healed. Yes, for what? Over 6 years. I had to rely upon a walking stick because of the arthritis I had. And then I went to Ireland in obedience to the Holy Spirit and had just undertaken a locational intercession, that means specific prayer for a specific place, in a specific reason, in a specific place, in a place called Knock, to what the prayer based on the mediation, the one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, so that Roman Catholics could be set free from that system of Satan. And have that they themselves could what? Hear directly from the Holy Spirit to bring themselves not by works, but on the basis of the atoning blood of Jesus Christ, and a gift of God by grace and by faith, they could know God personally and receive God into their lives, to be born again of the Spirit of God, having been washed and cleansed through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when that was made, yes, went off, I was called from the car when we would stopped. That place which is an abomination to God, that shrine. And God has a car and forgot to take the stick for some reason. And God walking around and found that I was healed. That's God. And it's been for the glory of God that I was healed. And it's the same with yourselves. It's not healing for selfish reasons to go in living a self life, but healing which gives glory to God. And this dear, dear man, not only had he been ostracized from society because he was a leper, he was a Samaritan too. Could you think of anything in that society, a combination of leper and Samaritan? He was totally cut off, despised and rejected, just like the Saviour was despised and rejected in his day by the Pharisees and the scribes. The Pharisees who hounded him. It's secular humanism today, it's Christendom, which defies the Word of God and ostracizes those who still stand true to the Word of God, like this servant of God. And Jesus answering said, "Were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? There are not found that return to give glory to God, save this stranger." And he said unto him, "Arise, go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole." So part of the healing process is, do you have faith in the healer himself? As I come to the close of this meeting, I'm going to pray, or the Holy Spirit is going to pray through me, in that same power and authority of the Lord Jesus Christ, the same power and authority that he had in his earthly ministry. And what's more, what did he say? He said to the disciples, St. John's Gospel, chapter 14, and verse 12 and 13, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, believeth on him." Are you believing on him? "The works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son." Are you going to bring your need now before the Father? Whatever it is, however hopeless or helpless it might appear, no matter what a doctor might have said, that you haven't long to live, Jesus is the healer. Oh, Father God, the Lord Jesus Christ, thy beloved one, was sent by thyself to restore on an individual basis all who will come unto thyself through repentance and faith and the cleansing of the power of the blood of Jesus. And the Lord Jesus Christ, also in his death and resurrection, brought that means of the atoning power of his blood to heal whatever sickness, whatever disease, because none is beyond him. And with that same power and authority, in the name of Jesus, I call and bring in the name of Jesus healing to those who are now reaching out in faith and taking from thyself the healing in the Lord Jesus Christ for thy glory. And thy glory alone is this asked, that you, O God, will be all in all. Amen. Thank you for being with me this afternoon. I shall be back tomorrow at 2:30 British time with the program, Rees Howell's Intercession Continuing. The Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and grant you his peace. Amen. Goodbye.
Something happened, and now I know he touched me and made